Solomon's book. We need it to lift our spirits these days. It was written for a time at the back of at the end of the first century, when the Middle East was dominated by the Romans. Christians were being persecuted by the state. Earthquakes were destroying cities, and it must have felt like everything was going wrong. It was written by John, an exile, a political refugee, to encourage the faithful. We don't need me to tell you that the world today is an unhappy place, what with the war in Ukraine, but also fighting in many other places, over 84 million refugees, religious intolerance in many places, more Christian martyrs than you can imagine, about 5,900 last year. And that, on top of the problems caused by climate change, closer to home, high rates of divorce and mental ill health, as well as all the losses caused by the COVID pandemic and poverty caused by inflation. We badly need some encouragement and hope. I was with a group this week where we looked at a passage that was written by Brian D. McLaren in his book called Naked Spirituality. Let me share it with you. Brian wrote of being on a retreat with a youth group out in the country. At one point he says, I walked several paces away from my friends, and I lay back on the grass, fingers interlocked behind my head, looking up, feeling strangely quiet and at peace. Something began to happen. I had this feeling of being seen, known, named, loved by someone bigger than the sky that expanded above me. Young science geek that I was, I pictured myself lying on a hill on a continent, on a little planet, in a little solar system, on the rim of a modest galaxy, in a sea of billions of galaxies. And I felt that the great big creator of the whole shebang was somehow noticing little me. It was as if the whole sky were an eye, all space were a heart, and I was being targeted as a focal point for attention and love. And the oddest thing began to happen as this realization sank in. I began to laugh. I wasn't performing, but I was laughing gently, but eventually, most uncontrollably, profound laughter surged from within me. It wasn't a reactive the kind that erupts when you hear a good joke or see someone do something ridiculous. It was more an overflowing laughter, as if all the space I'd been feeling opening up inside me was gradually filling with pure happiness. And once it reached the rim, it spilled over in incandescent joy. God loves me. Me, God, at this moment, I can feel it. The incredible thing is that this discovery or realization of God's love for him is also true for each one. I hope that each one of you here knows it. There are two Bible stories of a similar kind of experience happening for Jesus. One, when was baptized, and the other at the transfiguration, the voice from heaven which said, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." And that second time, "Listen to him." But we live in this world where sometimes bad things happen to good people. That sure was true for Jesus. We have that wonderful line in the letter to the Hebrews in chapter 12, which says, "Who for the joy set before him endured the cross. And he defeated all the evil pitched against him and rose to enjoy what was set before him. His return to heaven beside his heavenly Father." Even Jesus needed a picture of heaven to hold on to be able to cope. So we are given this picture of heaven in the book of Revelation to encourage and inspire us. It picks up on two different things, words from Psalm 23, and Jesus' own teaching about his being the Good Shepherd, which alongside John the Baptist's recognition of Jesus as the Lamb of God. So here we have the Lamb as our shepherd. Now last Sunday, I worshipped at St. Mary's Haddington with a number of farmers, shepherds, in the congregation. And the passage was all about catching fish. Here today, I suspect there are more fishermen than farmers, though I have met one who has caught sheep. Well, Jesus seemed to be acquainted with both occupations, despite being a carpenter to train himself, so we're all invited to use our imaginations. We've just sung words from Psalm 23, written by the shepherd King David. So with a deep understanding of the responsibilities that are involved, a passage in Revelation opens up on a scene with a great multinational community united in their worship of God. They're waving palm branches. But rather than shouting Hosanna, which means save us now, they're affirming that salvation has been secured for them by Jesus, the Lamb, as he has also done for us. After John has been told that these people are the ones who have come through the great tribulation and have been cleansed and healed, he then learns that, echoing the psalm, they will be led to springs of living water by their shepherd, the Lamb himself. Not only that, but there's a promise that God himself will wipe away every tear from their eyes. A line that speaks of deep concern, deep understanding, and tangible comfort. God's people will have a good future, however battered they may have been. If we think back to the other passages that we have read from John's Gospel, there is yet more to give us comfort and encouragement. Jesus speaks of his giving us eternal life, our never perishing, and that we can never be snatched from his hand, or even from his Father's hand. We are safe with him, safe for eternity. We can live with hope. One other idea, earlier in that passage, there's a bit that intrigues me. He says, Jesus says, "My sheep listen to my voice. I know them and they follow me. They listen to my voice." And we sang a hymn at the beginning about, "I heard the voice of Jesus say." I wonder how that happens. I read a story this week. It's a story of a man called William Devers. He was a 21-year-old corporal in the Marines fighting the Japanese in World War II. and he was a convinced agnostic. Encounter with the Japanese, and many were killed, and some hurt. Amongst them was the chaplain. And William went to help him. The chaplain told him that he had had a dream the night before when an angel told him he had to give William his Bible. So he listened to the message of the angel. He insisted that William fish it out of his pocket and keep it. William felt he had to be a dying man, so he found it and he stuffed it into his shirt pocket. 20 minutes later, another attack, and this time William was hurt. He lay thinking he was about to die, and then he passed out. When he came around, there was a pain in his chest. He put his hand there to see if there was blood, but there wasn't. But then he remembered that he had this little pocket Bible in his pocket, and his pocket was torn. So he pulled out the Bible, and there he could see a bullet had gone into it, and it got stuck in the middle at Psalm 91, verse 7, which read, 1,000 may fall dead beside you, 10,000 all around you, but you will not. Suspect actions by the chaplain who listened, actions by God spoke louder than words for him. Yes, that chaplain listened to God's message. But how do we? And I suspect that there are many answers to that question. How do we listen or hear Jesus' voice? I think there are as many ways to do that as there are people present here and lots more. There may be some who actually do hear a voice as we hear each other speaking. More likely, there may be some who are aware of words coming to their head, and they know that they've not caught them up, that they must have come from somewhere else, and probably Jesus. It could be that another person is speaking and there's a realization that what they're saying is what Jesus would be saying. Or it might be that we read something, and maybe it's in the Bible, or maybe it's somewhere else, and they become aware that that's Jesus' word for us. And again, we might notice a situation that just involved us learning what Jesus wants to say to us through it. Maybe that what we call our conscience works that way for us, a kind of inside knowledge that doesn't necessarily work with words, but senses what this message is. Well, we might even have a kind of physical reaction. I've heard of people who have a shiver and know that that's something that Jesus is saying to them. There are so many possibilities. But I leave you with that question. How do you hear his voice? A word of caution. Check out that if you're being asked to do something, check that it's not against the law, that it wouldn't hurt somebody or even yourself, and that it's the kind of thing that Jesus would have said himself from what we know from the Bible stories we have, to make sure that it really is the voice of Jesus. But learn to trust that you can hear it. And the passage in Revelation gives us a foretaste of the kind of worship that goes on in heaven. So let the words of the angels and the elders before the throne echo. echo in our ears. Praise and glory and wisdom and thanks and honor and power and strength be to our God.